Hi, welcome back to Man of Steel. Just thought I'd stick them behind us. Give you a wee bit more something interesting to look at than my face. Right, so here we are, maybe the last Man of Steel clip. As I said before, if you want to watch it along with me, listen to me blabble, 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 blabble. What you do is stick it, we're at now at the scene where Superman has crashed through Zod's ship, preventing him to shoot down the Lois Lane plane, and he's about to use his heat vision and say Krypton had its chance. So that's where I am just now. So if you want to pause this just now and then get to that bit, and then we can watch it together again, I'll try and say what I'm feeling at the time. Right now, as I was getting it to the bit, I just thought, why was this film not even more better? Better, well received, because it's just an outstanding superhero action movie. There is just so many people stuck in the past, you know, or have their own images of. I was even thinking about doing a whole video on Lex Luthor and Jesse Eisenberg and how he's actually brilliant in the role. But again, people are too transfixed on the cartoon Justice League series or the Superman cartoon series. You know, you look at Lois and Clark and that Lex Luthor, totally, totally different. Image wise and stuff like that. So here we go, we'll press play on the tape again, got to turn down the volume, got to do it because I get copyright and everything else. Next one I'll probably do is Batman v Superman. If any of you have watched my previous ones, we actually watched the film as well together. Had to take them down, but again I'll try and react roughly the same way as I did the 14th time I watched the film. So here we go. So right now he's just crashed and he's got his red eyes on, and Zod's saying, you know, you're going to destroy Krypton, you're going to destroy the future. And here we go, Krypton had its chance. I mean, that is a brave thing to do, grow up on a planet that you didn't belong, and then you're going to destroy so any hopes and chances of another planet surviving. But as I say, Krypton just squandered that. And of course, to save a planet Earth, it's not invaded anybody. It's, there we go, here we have the destruction of the cryo chamber and stuff like that, of the other egg chambers or whatever it is, being destroyed. And here we have the women getting ready to fly over to the spacecraft and kick some serious butt. It fascinates me how the thing that stops him is because the thing was upside down and the wee slot goes in. She comes, she's just cracking through that. Just before I turned this on as well, I was thinking about alien invasion movies. And, you know, you've got these superior spacecrafts and they're up against jet planes and everything else. And the aliens are, you know, advanced in the humans in every which way possible. Strength, ability, technology. If only Zod, you know, I mean, just imagine if Jor-El was alive and he got to go, you know, maybe Jor-El went to the Phantom Zone. You know, he switched places with Zod in this film, and Jor-El was the one that came back to Earth. Can you just think of the science that would have been, you know, brought forward to Earth? Can you see how much change it would be? You know, Jor-El wouldn't, you know, kill a planet just so Krypton can take its place. You know, Jor-El would somehow help society intermingle with these two Kryptonians, and it's quite sad to state, you know, that Krypton could have survived, but unfortunately, we had Zod that just wouldn't listen to reason, wouldn't coexist. There we go, Superman saving Lois, flying right past the, you know, making sure he doesn't get sucked right into the Phantom Zone. Now, in this week scene is he flies down and we see Perry White coming and he sees Superman in the distance and Lois and they can see that there is a relationship blossoming, you know. I mean, here we go. He's coming up for the kiss now. Perry White must have seen that, you know. So if she gets together with Clark, yep, he's seen the kiss. He's looking at the other guy. Oh, they've got a thing going on. Pardon my singing. And also when Clark appears, you know, and maybe a blossom happening there, Perry White must be thinking, is she going out with Clark and Superman? Or he knows. And if he knows, which is brilliant, it's good. You know, everything's good about that. You know, Perry White will stick up for Clark, or maybe the kiss is just to say thank you, Superman, for saving me. Maybe there is a bond there, and maybe the relationship between Lois and Clark is kept a secret. Mind you did get a sense in that in BVS when Lois comes in and she wants to go on the plane, and when she goes onto the plane and she kind of doesn't even talk to Clark that much. So maybe they are keeping the relationship a secret. Let me know your comments below about that one. And here we have Zod explaining that you have took everything from me. I think if somebody destroyed my hopes and my chances of rebuilding Earth and everything else, I'd be pretty miffed, especially if I had to share it in a planet that probably despised me, or in time I would grow so strong and powerful that Zod would end up either ruling the world. And here we have a big boom. Now, if I had one wee disappointment in this film was, and in most Superman films, I'd like more dialogue from Superman between Zod. I'm going to stop you, Zod. You are a monster. And here we go, a big lash. But again, this is Superman who's thinking, what am I going to do next? How am I going to put him down? You know, we're going to constantly fight all the time. He is worried for people around him. We have Zod using the heat vision, which is now synonymous all over the internet about how well it's linked to BVS. You can just imagine, Batman on the ground watching this fold out. Again, people complaining about too much destruction as one building crashing into the next. Well, he could have either done that, flew away, and then Zod would have just basically destroyed building after building, people. He could have just killed thousands. If he flew over, if Zod, I love that bit, skipping by the LexCorp van. Put it this way, okay? If Superman grabs Zod, takes him outside outside the city into the farmyard and stuff like that, do you think Zod would have went or went, you need to fight me here, pal, or I'm gonna just keep killing? But I think when you get wrapped up in a fight, you're not thinking. Right? And who's to say Superman can actually grab Zod and hold him for that amount of time as he's flying through? Yep, he could go through the speed of light. Well, so could Zod. So Zod could easily just fly him over and over again. But again, this sort of destruction takes place in a sort of small. You know, if you think about the size of Metropolis and the amount of buildings that have went down, here we have it. He's on the construction site. You can buy that statue with Superman firing his eye. You know, his eyes up at Zod with the big bar. In the background, we see "Keep Calm, Call for the Batman." Some people compare this scene as Zod somehow lifts up and his armor comes off, something to do with a manga cartoon series or something, Goku or whatever. I don't follow manga. I tried manga, and I just felt it was too over-explanatory that they were spoon-feeding me. And, you know, the emotions in manga are over the top. I'm sad. I just couldn't get into it. But I read some, but it's not for me. And here we have the Zack Snyder, let's see what it looks like being Superman and punching a guy mid-air. Look at the speed of that. The only closest thing this had, maybe with a Christopher Reeve movie, I'll put my face through the building. There's a special edition or director's cut of Superman 2 by Richard Donner, which is far superior than what came out before. I prefer that. And as I said, probably in another video, that Richard Donner didn't want travelling around the world in the first one. And here we have the wee satellite that has got the Wayne Industries logo right at the bottom there. A good way to say, you know, Bruce Wayne is alive in this world. There's a scene in the Christopher Reeve movie where it's just before, I think, the fight between Zod and he's flying through the skyline. And that's the first sort of great wee image of Christopher Reeve flying between the buildings of Metropolis. And it's just that one we've seen, and I don't know why it was ever cut out. You know, it may be like a puppet figure or something like that, or a clay animation, but it was pretty good. Just try and see, it only lasts for a second, but it made the difference, rather than just Superman, Christopher Reeve acting in the backdrop of green screen and stuff like that. And here we have, now, as I said, a lot of people, the guy's burning his eyes, Zod is going to kill this family, kill everybody. So Zod has got no reason to live. So in a way, for getting Clark to kill Zod, it's in Zod's eyes, pardon the pun, Superman, you know, he's beaten Superman. He's made him turn against what he was. And here we have the greatest reaction. He falls down to his knees, you know, he screams. That is what we needed. This is sort of a lesson learned. And as I said, Superman has killed Zod before. And another similar sort of storyline. And he has killed before. But for me, that character, it's for the greater good. It's sacrificing his soul, that bit of soul, to do the greater good. You know, it's like Star Trek with Spock. You know, the ways of the many outweighs the many, ways of the few and stuff like that. And here we have comforting Clark and everything else. Now, in Christopher Reeve Superman 2, the guy cracked, you know, Superman breaks his arm and breaks his hand or whatever, crushes it and throws him down to his bottom pit. He doesn't even check if he's if they're alive, you know. There's deaths in this fight scenes in just about every DC movie, and that's just what happens in real life. They don't go out the way to kill you, but if you try to kill them, things could happen. You know, if you're shooting somebody with a rocket launcher and Superman I don't know, sort of explodes it before it hits him, then something ricochets from that rocket and kills the person that fired it. Is it Superman's fault? No. It's that person's fault for being the bad guy, but being in the wrong place and doing bad things. You know, if I was Superman, I wouldn't feel too guilty about that. You know, accidents happen, as we see in the workplace. And here we have Superman. And I love the dialogue that Henry Cavill has, you know, being Superman, that sort of strong, confident thing. You know, you're trying to track down where I stay, you know, where I hang my cape up and stuff like that. Don't even bother trying to find my secret identity. You know, basically, you're it, you know. And here we have the woman saying, oh, I think he's hot. Again, is she going to be the future Hal Jordan, aka Green Lantern's girlfriend? Who knows? Maybe she's just put in there like wee Jimmy that gets killed in the extended scene of BVS. And she's just a kind of, you know, a homage to that sort of character. And we've got to put in mind that there's some characters in comics that, yeah, you could put them in, but they don't really have much to do in the film. You think about, you know, even Jimmy in the Christopher Reeve movies, he got saved once, but apart from that, it was just this wee character that would bob up and down again. And here, I love this moment. This, for me, makes me feel happy, because even though Jonathan is dead, he sees an image of Clark wearing a cape, thinking, this is, you know, this is something that my boy could be. You know, this is maybe the place where he gets the idea that he can be a saviour. Now, some people commented about, oh, where is, how did Clark, was heroes around at that time when Clark was being out? No. But Medieval Knights was, and heroic figures from the past have often wore capes of some sort, you know. And here we have Clark Kent entering the Daily Planet, and Lois Lane just about to say, oh, welcome to the planet. Thanks, Lois. Great wee bit. As I say, he cycled on the bike. I'd like to see him on the bike and stuff. You know, you've seen images of him on... Maybe it's not a big deal, is it, to see him on a bike? Until we are coming up to the final moments of Man of Steel. And I think it's... I hope you enjoyed this as much as I have, and watching it with us. And to thank you, I want to give you this sort of code for those people who maybe have not watched it. Or maybe you know somebody that hasn't watched it. Or maybe you're going on holiday and you have a kid that is that's very annoying on a plane, and you want to give them something to look at. Well, here we have screenplay by David S. Goyer. David S. Goyer and Christopher Nolan. Story by just Charles Rovan. See, always look at the credits. Okay. Deborah Snyder. For those people on my page that asked who that woman was standing beside Zack Snyder, that's his wife. Okay. His partner. Everything else. Always read the credits, even before the film starts or after the film starts. You know, it sort of educates you in a way, because a lot of people didn't know that, you know, for instance, the credits, he wasn't down, Superman wasn't down as Superman, he was down as Kal-El or Clark. So for those... for those people that want to silence the kids and everything else, here is a code for you to do it. Now, of course, you can pause it. Are we ready? Okay, if you can't make that out, it's not to worry. It's, the DVD is about £5 or something like that. Just now, you know, you can get it reasonably cheap. And the cast isn't coming up. I've just went past Russell Crowe. A Warner Brothers presentation. In association with Legendary Pictures. I was actually hoping to... A Zack Snyder film, yes. A Zack Snyder film. And there's the logo. Superman. No. I'm just going to fast forward this a wee bit. Can't do it with two handies. Sorry about that. Here we go. Right, here we go. Just to show you. And then that'll be the end of the tape. Here is the cast. Notice there is no Superman. It's Clark Kent, Kal-El. So he's not yet Superman. Okay, so thanks very much. I know all this is probably not a lot of your idea of watching YouTube and, you know, listening to me talk through a film, you in the house watching a DVD. But again, I'm doing that, you know, I'm not a YouTuber. I don't have the gift of the gab, I don't have the technology. All I've got is just me talking, and if you want to listen, it's fine. If you don't want to listen, but you want to hear my views and my positivity, you check out Facebook page, Man of Steel, Fan Gives Hope. If you love the page, and there's also a group called Friends of Man of Steel, Fan Gives Hope, please join us, check the albums, check all the positive videos out there, the DCU, check the notes, and you know, and please, you know, leave your negatives comments at home, and let's be positive out there. Okay, so thanks, and hopefully you tune in on the next one.